Hey, what's up, everyone? How are we doing? How are you guys doing, Cosmo Prof? Joico family, I know everybody is, I'm sure, enjoying their Monday afternoon today, or unless you're on the West Coast and it's still kind of morning. I am Ricardo Santiago, also known as Stylist Ricardo Santiago on Instagram and pretty much every other social media platform. We today have something pretty exciting that we're bringing to you, and this is the evolution, the second part of my angle method technique. Okay, so we debuted this, boy, I can't even remember when we did the first angle method. I think it's probably been at least a few months since we did the first part, and we had some great success with that, some great feedback. So we were trying to figure out how can we evolve this, right? And figured out that this is a great next step as far as how to evolve this particular technique. So before we go into it, I'm just gonna show you, like, so here you have a quick reference of, this is the first angle method. We have these charts and stuff available. If you need them, just let us know, we'll get them to you. But this is the first one. Now we're working on the second one. So the first one we worked mostly with right angles and acute angles. And now this time, a lot of weaving and slicing. We're changing it up and we're going and shifting into more of an obtuse angle, which means anything over 90 degrees. So if it's acute, it's in, within, or below 90 degrees. You know those little symbols? I can never figure them out. You know what I mean? Greater than or less than. But here we have a good visual reference. So we're going more than 90 degrees for the obtuse versus the less than, which is the acute. And what this is going to do is this is going to create some bigger, more bold color placement. So what I mean by that is, essentially we're going to be using almost forms of black coloring, but working off of angles so that way it doesn't look too like incorrectly placed. You know what I mean? So you don't want it to look like you've just got like a brick and a brick and a brick of color. That's great when you're putting in extensions, but when you're putting in color, you need to diffuse those. So this is the mannequin that we're going to be working on. As you can see, I have already put the base formula on. I have already also prepped her for the color by using Defy Damage Pro Series 1. I will show quickly how to use that as we go into this. But we've prepped it. I've got the base formula on. Everybody knows how to put on a base formula, so there was really no point in showing you how to do that. What I did do that I will specify is I went a little bit more shallow around the hairline. So you can see that here and here as well. So that's only about a half inch to an inch of a stretch. And then as we worked our way up and into the interior, I stretched that more, about 2 inches or so. So it gradually starts to get a little bit deeper as you work your way up. Now here is our finished product so that you can see. Let me get this clip out of here. So this gives you a good visual of what it looks like. And we decided to just curl a quadrant of it. So this is 1/4, the front part here, and you can see how nice and bright you can still keep this around the face, right? With still maintaining that shadow root. And then we're still keeping a lot of internal depth. And then also the back, we left that straight because I thought that it would be great to just show you how much dimension you can create without having to put the curls into it. Because we know a lot of times, I would say, I know for me, at least like 90% of the times that my clients bring me a photo of inspiration, it's always curled, right? It's always something off of Pinterest or Instagram, and it's always a curled image. So I thought, let's show what it looks like straight. Let me move this clip so you can really see it. So that you can see how well those colors blend together and how much dimension that really creates.
And as you're kind of talking a little bit about that, we have people joining in from everywhere, including and especially our Joico family. So hello to you all. We've got people in from Houston. Where else is everybody writing in from? We would love to know. So with that, somebody also already asked what the formula is. So I'm just going to flash this up here for you really quick. We went ahead and put the entire formulation from start to finish, which is actually quite simple right here. So you can screenshot this. Also, make sure that you follow along on social media, again, as Ricardo said, to Stylist Ricardo Santiago, or of course also Joico and Cosmoprof Beauty. They will be showing the afters and so forth there. Yes. So, hey, Kelly.
If you're curious as to where that wonderful voice is coming from, that's my wife, Angela.
Hi.
Who's helping out here. Now, the other thing that I was going to say right before that, and I think that it's a great reference as we went into formulas, that we are using, so we're using our DD creams. So this is a demi-permanent cream-based color. And I know a lot of people, they tend to usually go straight for a a lot of people tend to go straight for more of a liquid base, which these are great. So these are our liquid-based demi-permanent colors. And these are more acidic, whereas our dimensional deposit are more alkaline. So this is, you're going to get more deposit and also more opacity. The reason that I'm using this versus using the liquid demi is for control, right? So I want to be able to manipulate that color, and I really want to get a stronger deposit at the base, and especially where I'm stretching that through. So that's why I'm using the cream versus the liquid. That's usually like one of the first questions I get, so I figured let's go ahead and get that one out of the way. I love that my friend Sherry Rite, who's also an educator with us, she likes to use the reference of coffee and tea. So the liquid is more like a tea, it's more sheer, whereas the cream is more of a coffee and it's a little bit more opaque. Right? So that is why we're using that. Again, we've got the base put on. Let's get right into the color. I'm hoping to achieve two things today. And the first of those things is I hope that you guys get some great information out of this and something that's valuable that you'll be able to use in the salon. Even if you just get one little aha moment from it, that would be great. The second thing that I'm hoping to achieve is actually finishing this mannequin. So if you see that, document that. This will be a day in history that has never been done, whereas I will have finished an entire demonstration. Don't hold me to it.
While live.
All right, so going straight into the sectioning, this is what creates the technique, right? This is the basis for it. So I've split off my quadrant, and you can see I'm actually going just below that apex, between the apex and the crown, so that it puts me behind the ear on both sides, okay? And then from that, you're going to work within your individual quadrants, and you'll see that the colors will line up. The sectioning is really meant to create more cohesiveness. So we're going to come down just about an inch off of the top of that section there. And what you're going to do is keep your comb straight in, right? We're not going to turn at an angle. We're going to go straight in. We're going to draw in our section. So we're going to go out and then down and then out and then down and out, down, out, and then you should see it coming out the other side. Go ahead and take that, split in half, and there you go. All right, so it's like perfect steps. That's what we want to create. We're trying to create these 90 degree angles, and that's what we're going to position everything off of.
Now, really quick before you move forward, and if anybody has any questions as we go on here, please don't hesitate to ask. If you need to see the formula again, that's no problem. If you need him to show something again so that you can make sure you got it, let us know. But why the angle method?
What?
Why the angle method? Why this so, technique over any other?
The reason that I like this technique is because it's so buildable and it's so customizable. And then what's great about it is I'm going to give you a lot of visuals, a lot of references, and a lot of ways to use this within this particular technique. But the great thing is you can take this sectioning or you can adapt it however you want. Everything that we do in here, it's all based on geometry. It's all based on different angles. So all I did was take that and put a name to it and find different ways to apply it. We'd like to try to find techniques that haven't been done, that are original, sectioning that's more unique. So with this, I thought that really this would create a different technique that is very easy to use, very salon friendly, and that can be done quickly, right? So you'll see here as we move into this, how much you can actually get done in a short period of time. So I did say I was gonna show a quick demonstration of how to use Defy Damage. So this is always going to be your first step. Before you do anything else in the salon, this is your number one. As far as your color goes, you can even do this as a standalone. But ideally what you wanna do is give the can a good shake, make sure that you're mixing everything up really nice, and then you're gonna spray this in short bursts right down the length of the hair. That's it, doesn't take much. You can see I only did a couple of sprays there. And then you're going to grab your favorite, I like a natural bristle brush, and then you're just gonna brush that through. And that's it. Now it's been perfectly distributed. That's going to protect the hair from the entire process. It's a bond optimizing spray, so it's going to protect, rebuild, strengthen, and also optimize your color. So you'll get better color deposit and also greater lift with your lightener without having to adjust your formula or anything else.
And just confirming, this model was already pre-treated prior to, yes, so that we can make the best use of your viewing time.
Yeah, so she's already good to go. That's why I just did a little, and you can't overuse it, so it's okay. All right, so going into the technique itself, what I wanna do is I'm gonna take these corners, right? So these inside 90 degree corners, I'm gonna go off of that and imagine that this is my line that I'm using, and I'm just gonna come out. So that's creating that obtuse angle, versus if I use the inside corner, that's more of an acute. So that would give me smaller sections. I want big sections, I wanna work fast. So I'm gonna use the outside corner and then come in. So I'll start first here, and this is just gonna take that entire hairline. There it goes. Okay, so here's my hairline. And then a little red ball of yarn or something up in there. I don't know what that is.
It's mannequin hair.
Yeah. So then we'll go straight off of here, do the same thing, coming straight across. Diagonally across. You see now here's our angle. It comes out and then across. So that's more of an obtuse versus the acute. Right? And then we'll do the same thing here.
And this is really great to do if you have a shadow root or retouch. As you can see, the sectioning kind of stays separated for you. But you can use this technique if you aren't doing a shadow root.
Yeah, absolutely. I just like to do that just because it's simplicity. It's easier to wear. It's easier to apply the technique. And then also, as you continue to move forward with your client, I feel like we're really moving into a time where clients really want less maintenance, and this is going to give them an opportunity to achieve that and have less maintenance, to where they don't have to come in every 6 to 8 weeks, except for maybe for a root touch-up, and that's it. If they wanted to add more dimension, then you can absolutely always add some more pops of brightness and blonde, but you don't have to, right? So what's nice is they could come one or two appointments in between, just touching up their roots, keeping it nice and low cost, and then every, you know, second or third time, then you put in some more highlights, okay?
Or lowlights.
Yeah, or lowlights, whichever one you want. So what I like to do here is, because I don't want to just make this whole thing blonde, right? What I want to do is I'm gonna weave this out a little bit, but I'm gonna put like deeper and higher points to really break that up. Before I do that, what I want to do first is I'm gonna apply a little bit more of my base formula. And what's nice about this too is, whereas I typically like to use 3, 4, 5, 12 formulas, this is just 2 formulas, all right? So this is keeping it really easy, very simple. And what you're gonna do is just stretch that root color out. So you see, as soon as I squeeze, how much color builds up right there? All right, we'll do that there and we'll do that there. So you see how that buildup of color happens? Now what we wanna do is diffuse that color. So I can either continue to work this color that I've built up on my finger and stretch that through and give it a really stretched root, or I can do what I'm going to do, which is keep it a little bit more shallow by switching fingers and then stretching it until the color blurs out.
And for this, you definitely want to have a towel on hand so that you can keep your gloves clean in between sections.
Yeah, I mean, it's so important to work nice and clean. What I will do is I'm going to add just a touch more color on the top, because I want to create more internal depth and keep it brighter on the outside, on the perimeter. So I'm just going to put a little bit of that color back on there.
So in today, Ricardo's demonstrating the implementation of obtuse angles in one way. Again, you could do an entire client's head of hair with only obtuse angles or only right angles. So this is just one of the ways to incorporate the usage of the angle method.
Absolutely. So here we're gonna just break this up. Okay, that was it. Just a few deep zigzag points there. And then I'll take this piece here and I'll go ahead and just clip this out of the way.
And really quick, someone's asking just for a recap. So thank you for joining. If you're just coming in, share with us where you're from. And what Ricardo is doing is the Angle Method 2.0. That's a signature technique that he created using acute, right, and obtuse angles, your basic geometry. For those who are interested in the formula, it's super simple today. There they are right there. And Ricardo.
And now I'm putting on the right
there. Ricardo is waiting for me to come back.
Okay, so here, this is what we're doing, right? We've got this whole section right here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start building up my lightener, but you want to start like midway down. You don't want to come up to the top, not yet. All right, so start here, work your way down. I think I just peeped at the screen. I saw my friends from Joico Europe on there. Hi, Wendy. Hey, everybody else. And you want to just continue to saturate and blend this down. Make sure that you're getting really good saturation there. Now, once you've done that, then you can do one of two things here. You can either feather this up with your brush, or you can do what I like to do. And I like to work with my hands a lot. So what I'm going to do is just work this upwards using my fingers. But what I want to make sure is that I'm avoiding going right onto the root. What happens is it doesn't look like it, and it's actually kind of hard to tell. But sometimes if you have any lightener, so you see I have some lightener here on my fingers. If I happen to touch that root, it will create a little hot spot on the root. So you want to avoid that by just going right up to it to where you can see this transition happen. So you can see how, let's see if I can turn it this way. Nice and deep and dark right here. And it starts to progressively get lighter as until it goes into the lightener. And that's what I want to see, is that diffusion of color as it works through. The other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to lift this, and I'm going to make sure that I take a little bit of lightener here, and I'm just going to diffuse that a little bit closer on the underneath. All right, so this is totally just done with my hands. Again, avoiding that root area so that I don't create any hot spots.
So now that Ricardo's kind of giving you the base of what he's going to do, he'll probably move through that part just a little bit faster. But Let us know if you have any questions about that part.
Yeah, and then, so I'm also just like to address, because there's, again, it's always the questions that we get. What kind of foils are you using? What products are you using? All that good stuff. So I am using Joico's Artistry Foils, which you can pick up at CosmoProf as well. That's what the side looks like. That's what the top looks like. They're nice and big, and that's why I like to use them, especially on longer hair. So they're 7x14, and that's going to allow me to just kind of work through. And instead of folding this over, I don't want to risk any of this lightener touching up here. So what you're just going to do is close it in like that. Nice and easy. Okay, so I'll take this top piece. And now for this, what I'm going to do is stretch that root color a little bit further out.
And we have a question from Kelsey. Hi, Kelsey. She asks, why do you do the base color before you lighten? And I'm guessing you mean as opposed to after.
Okay, so the reason for that is because, which is a great question, Kelsey. The reason that I'm doing that is because I want to create that depth at the root. And by putting that base color on first, letting it sit for a little bit, that's giving me the opportunity to create a little bit more deposit there on the root, and then I'm melting that lightener into it. It's important to note that when you're doing this, you really have to make sure that you're using a demi-permanent. If you're doing this with a permanent, you really run a high risk of potentially creating a hard line transition area where it could have like a warm band. So be careful when you're doing that. Make sure that you're using a demi-permanent, not a permanent, so that you don't end up with that hot spot, is what I like to call it. So.
Yep, that's a great question, Kelsey.
Yeah. So from here, this is where you can really start to customize, okay? So if you wanted to, you could take this whole section and create one color, right? So this could be all a low light, and then the next block a highlight, and then the next block a low light. And that still works really well, especially when you're working within subtle formulas and levels and things like that. What I'm doing that I did on this side is I'm actually going to go right off of my right angle here, and I'm going to take this and go straight down to this corner and split that almost in half. You're going to have one side that's going to be larger than the other right there, okay? And then I will do the underneath as the low, the top as the high. And these are gonna sit on top of each other, but that's what creates all that depth that we see over here on this side.
Awesome. And apologies if it's blurry. We're working on just staying still, but also getting you the best view possible. So stay with us. And if anybody has any questions, feel free to ask those. Anybody who's just tuning in, thank you so much to everyone for being here today on what we think is probably your day off.
Hopefully y'all are taking a day off, enjoying yourself a little bit.
A few people asked if you are able to rewatch this. I know it was answered in comment. Yes, you'll be able to watch the replay on Cosmo Prof Station or Facebook, as well as Joyaco's. And Joyaco, as well as Ricardo and Cosmo Prof, will be sharing the afters and so forth as well.
We'll also make sure that we post, you know, some behind the scenes stuff and all that. So if you aren't already, make sure that you go and follow my page at Stylist Ricardo Santiago, and then also are following Joyaco, because that's where you'll be able to get some more of like the steps and the good stuff that leads up to this.
And if y'all are lucky and I can do it without Ricardo looking, I've got a really fun behind the scenes video that I might
check. No, ma'am. No, siree, Bob. It's not getting posted. Okay, so here you can see I stretched that root, but if you notice here, I'm leaving these ends. You see how the ends are actually a little bit dry? That's what I want to see. I want it to go from that really deep natural and then just subtly start transitioning out. That's what that blur starts to do. So make sure that you're really focusing on that and blurring that color out, because if not, then you really lose the effect of this. The other thing too is if you're doing this on a person, probably works a little bit better than on the mannequin on the tripod that keeps trying, although they like to bob the head around too, so.
So really quick to those of you who are with us right now, if you know of somebody who would benefit from this or maybe wasn't able to join today, you are able to share while we're watching or share after by hitting, of course, the share button. So please feel free to do that. We would love to have as many people as possible see it.
Yeah. Okay, so again, here we go. We're applying that lightener, really focusing on the mids to ends first, and then working our way up. Okay, so if you're doing this motion, really kind of back feathering it up, you're already gonna start blurring that line up. So I like to go at a bit of a side to side as I'm working that saturation. And then once I get my saturation down really well, then I switch and start feathering it upwards. And that's what's gonna help to blur that line. Now, I'm gonna come in and we're just gonna back further up with our fingers. You can also use the surface painting method like this and just use your fingers to diffuse that color in. There. There. You can see it almost starts to create a little bit of what looks like a tease at that root. And that's good. That's what we want to see. Okay, so now I can come in with another foil. And if you notice, I'm only using the foils on the highlighted section. Again, this is just to save you some time so that you don't have to foil every piece of hair on the head. Just foil what's in what has lightener on it and then leave the rest out. That'll speed things along.
And I'll just go ahead and flash the formulas again for those of you who are interested. It's also listed in the comments, but Ricardo is using Lumishine DD creams as well as Blonde Life with 20 ball.
Yes. Blonde Life, if you haven't used it before, fantastic lightener. You will get 9 plus levels of lift out of that. So if you haven't used it, make sure that you go pick some of that up, give it a try. Most of our intro kits and stuff that you get have little samples in there, so you can always try it that way also. So here, this brush has a lot of color on it. I just wanna add a little bit more on here.
And that's a great tip too, is to, Ricardo uses Color Track brushes, and they have a really great XL brush as well as just a standard large brush. So that's gonna be another way that you can work through your surface a little bit more quickly as well.
Yeah, so here you can see, this is a good visual example of how we stretch that root, right? So I have one hand that I'm using to pull the product through, and then I have another one that's more like my dry hand. And this one, as this pulls the product through, this is stretching it through the dry bits through the ends. And then alternating the two of them really helps to diffuse that color out completely. And what that'll do is not just, it won't just create the blurred effect, but it also starts to soften out the color so that you have stronger deposit into softer deposit through the ends. Now here, we'll just stretch this a little bit. That's already got some color build up on that root, so I don't need to add any more. And now we can go straight into adding our lightener.
So, and Ricardo's almost worked through that back quadrant just that quick. In addition to taking the time to talk and teach, he's worked through and covered quite a bit of ground pretty quickly. So that's one of the advantages of tying in the obtuse angles.
Yeah, just, you know, bigger sections. I would highly recommend for most of you, if you're gonna try to do this, you might want to take some of these sections that I'm working and just shrink them down, maybe cut these in half. Do the placement and everything exactly the same, but even with this particular section that I'm working right now, it is quite wide, as you can see. So you wanna make sure that your melts are nice and cohesive. You either have to work more in a side-to-side motion, making sure that you're working across horizontally so that you have even tension, or just split it in half so that way you don't run the risk of having stronger saturation in some spots versus others, and then you have inconsistencies there. All right, so this, we will fold it over.
You know when you try to hurry. Something like that happens.
Trying to sneak out on me.
Aw, Joanne Lewis, thanks for the sweet comment. She says, hi, Ricardo, thank you for teaching me always.
Aw, thanks, Joanne.
I love Joanne.
Okay, so we're now on the last section here on this top. And now with this one, it's not quite as large as the other ones. So what I did on the last time, I did still kind of split it, but I changed my angle slightly. So I'm going to do the same thing here. Whereas instead of going off of here, obviously I can't, so I'm gonna go off that inside corner and I'm just gonna take the top portion off. And what that'll do is that's gonna give me a little bit of brightness just below the crown here.
So there you created an acute angle versus an obtuse.
Exactly, so it's integrating the different angles in together.
As you work around your client's head.
Yeah, that's why I say this is a great technique to really customize and make your own. Because you can dissect and interchange angles however you feel the need to, right? And then this one also, what I'm gonna do is not stretch that root color quite as far. So you see, we're just gonna build that up. And this is what I mean by working horizontally. I'm working across the length back and forth. And then once I've built that up, I'm just gonna take that in one stretch and blur that out.
So this is great. As you all can see, Ricardo is using the cream series. He's also using Blonde Life for blonde, of course, and you can do this with fashion color. You can even do this with liquid toners.
Absolutely.
So that's the great, yeah, that's one of the other great things of using the angle method.
Yeah, so the previous one that we did, we used reds, right? So everything was based with red color, and we did it with almost all permanents. This one, we're doing it more so in the blonde family. So it's just to show diversity, really.
And but
you can absolutely do this too with color intensities or, you know, anything within our color line would work great with it.
And as you do this, as you're formulating and choosing your angles and what direction to go, literally, you can incorporate baby lights or chunky highlights or statement pieces, as we call them, or color melting. What?
We don't say chunky.
We don't say chunky. We call them statement pieces.
We call them bold statement pieces.
Yes. Sounds a little bit more
commercial.
Yes.
We want it to sound mainstream.
And you could even do this with Joyico's cream blonde or cream lightener, correct?
Yeah, so if you use the Blonde Life cream lightener, this works really well with that as well. It's actually maybe even an easier consistency to do this with. So here we're just gonna make sure that you have a good grip on it, right? Because you don't want it to move around too much. And then just kind of soften this up. Same thing underneath. just a little bit right there to blur it in, and then even out that saturation. Good to go. My biggest problem is I keep putting my comb in the wrong spot. Pull that.
So while Ricardo's just working through there, it would be really a great time to tell you that so a few of you have asked that, yes, Joico does offer education on demand. So you can see that on the website. They also have a huge library of other great artists on their IGTV, as well as Ricardo's previous angle method, the intro, is available on his IGTV. So you can kind of recap that to get a little bit more of a foundation of this technique. But even picking it up right here, you can still really get a great understanding of how to use the technique.
All right, so we're getting into the top section here, so I'm gonna have you come in a little bit tighter just so that we can see this. All right, so here, right, what we wanna do is, so the last time we were working on the inside corners, we're still working on these corners here, the opposite of the one before, and then we're just gonna angle this up, okay? So that goes up, there's our first section. Our second goes up the same way. And then our third here. And then there's our last one. So
can you just pull again, that tight so you can see?
Yeah, so here you can see this is an obtuse angle, right? So we're going versus an acute would be like this.
Which so is those closer are, to
those
the
are two acute angles versus the one big obtuse angles. And what's nice is as we get to this section here, now you can see these are a lot smaller. So I'm just gonna take these are all gonna be their own individual colors. So this will be high, low, high, low, okay?
So that was Debbie's question. She asks, what makes this different than the standard method? So it would be the inclusion of obtuse angles, which is of course your greater than 90 degree angle.
Yeah, which is again, just bigger sections, bigger, blockier sections. So, and then again, you know, use your discretion, use your expertise as you work through. Not everyone's head is going to be the same. And I think that that's really important to remember, because a lot of times we go into every situation thinking, oh, I'm just gonna use this technique and I'm gonna do it this way. But in actuality, you can't really do that because not everyone works the same way.
And what's also important to consider too is when you have a client who has finer hair versus thicker hair. In those cases, you might want to use an acute angle versus an obtuse for a client who has finer hair.
Sorry, Maddie here. She's leaning on me.
She has fallen asleep. She's so relaxed.
The scalp massage comes later. You gotta keep him awake until that part happens.
And Debbie says you could call this the zigzag method. We did consider using the word zigzag, but because there's such specific types of angles and the way to use them with each other, we went ahead with the angle method.
Yeah, and it's all based off of that first section, really. So you can take a lot and just kind of build off of that.
And Casey asks, what results does this give? So you all will be able to see the afters on the social media for Cosmoprof, Joico, and of course, stylist Ricardo Santiago. But this is gonna give that expensive looking, customized, dimensional look to your client, depending on whether they're wanting more depth or more brightness.
It's really, honestly, y'all, this is, wow, that sounded a little expensive.
Did you say gal or y'all?
Well. This is really like, it's creating a, it's almost like a balayage, but like more of a painting method. So you're combining balayage and color melting and painting all together. And I'm not using a balayage lightener. That's the nice thing about this is I'm using Blonde Light, which you can always paint with, but in this case in particular, it's really just being used to saturate, and then you're blurring it out yourself. You're using your own tools, your hands or your brush, whichever one you choose, to blur that color out.
And of course, if you want a greater pop of blonde, you can go a little bit more heavy-handed with the lightener.
Absolutely. The more saturation you get, the more brightness you're going to achieve. But just know that you're not necessarily going to want that as you get up into the hairline or up towards the top, right? Okay. You might want to be careful of that because that can cause some problems.
And this is a really great technique, specific with the colors and the placement that Ricardo's using for today. This is great for somebody who's been blonde and wants a lower maintenance blonde, and maybe wants to transition back to more of their natural.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's where this particular application and this particular formula, I think, embodies that completely. Like, you're going to see, and we'll show the other side again really quick, because I know there's a lot of people that came on after and didn't see the finished on the other side there. But we'll show that so that you can see how we're taking basically someone who's an all-over blonde with very little dimension and adding all the dimension into it to make it look like they've been coming to the salon for months, building on doing balayage over and over and over to create a very expensive looking result, but it's done in one step.
And really quick, let's take a few questions. So we have Zoe Aitken-Smith asks, what would you charge for this application? And if I can, I'll just step in there for a second.
$1 million.
$1 million. No, of course you're going to customize, you're going to integrate this with your pricing for your area, how much time you spend. And of course you always want to consider how much hair the client has, how long it is, thick, curly, all those things that make this service customized to them. So we would definitely suggest customizing pricing. If somebody were to ask that price range, we would probably give them a range.
And I'll say, honestly, because it's gonna be different with each person, you're gonna see that you might wanna start looking at maybe pricing this more by time versus by the service itself. So I would say, well, if this is going to take me 3 hours, then, you know, you're like $300-$400, just throwing a number out there, right? So that's probably the way I would look at pricing that.
And you could also highlight the fact that it's probably every other service or every other two services that it's almost like how you would do a full highlight and a partial or a half in between. You don't always want to necessarily do a full highlight on a client. So of course that's going to fluctuate their pricing. Debbie asks a great question. I think you're confirming what you're seeing. She says, so you would alternate more blonde or more color depending on the depth.
Exactly.
Yep. As well as what the client's asking for.
Yeah, so it's really just all about what you're working with and what they want. Like, you just have to find that line and ride it, because it's your job to try to figure out what it is that they're asking for.
Just open that really fast and just show it how seamless. That's so pretty.
Yeah, so you want to figure out what it is that they're asking for, and then also just figure out how to deliver it. So, but within reason, because a lot of times we know that our clients like to ask for things that aren't necessarily achievable, and it's our job to be the professionals and say, sorry, Karen, it's not gonna work.
And so another question coming in from Dana, just to recap, she asks, what is the low light formula? So here the base and the low light are the same, which is of course using Joico's Lumishine DD cream, and Ricardo is using Blonde Life and 20 Vol for the highlights.
Yeah, so here, you know, I just built on a little bit more of my base formula right there, and now I'm just stretching it through. And you can see here what I did is I'm stretching it first with my index and middle finger, but as soon as I get to where it's already starting to blur itself out, I'm gonna switch fingers so that way I'm not dragging as much of that color through. And this is gonna help to really just finish blurring it out. You want it to just feel like it's gone completely dry. And that's what we wanna see. So here, and you can see the saturation as it starts to lose and go into basically nothing through the ends.
And Casey says, can't wait to see the after. I have blonde clients who don't want to be blonde anymore. Yes, you're awesome. Gonna love the after. It's absolutely beautiful. So okay. Ricardo, on the before, you were gonna show the results.
Yeah, so here, let's show that side as we go into the front, because the front is always such a tricky part to get. I know everyone always is curious about how it works around the face.
And this is not toned, and we do have a little bit of a challenge of lighting in here, but you can see the dimension that's created there. You've got that very important lightness around the face, and a perfectly melted root.
Yeah, and I'm just going to comb through it really quick just so that you can see the way that this lays here.
Depth in all the right places.
Right, so nice and bright around the face. And then I like to always position a good amount of depth right behind that front face frame piece right here. And that's what kind of, as you can see right here where it starts to lay as that lives. That really makes that face pop even more. We're really trying to work that contour to accent certain things. So her cheekbone is really gonna stand out. And also her eyes against that lightness with the dark sitting over the top. It's going to bring a lot of attention to that area right around the face. So that's why I think it's so important when you're talking about contouring and color placement, to make sure that you have a reason for it. And then also here in the back, just so you don't think we're trying to hide behind
the curls.
The curls. And since that back section's already done, I can take these clips out. And you can see that it does also work really well straight.
And this is not toned.
Lots of dimension. Again, yes.
How gorgeous.
There's no tone on this. So if it was toned, you would see even more pop, even more dimension.
What do you guys think? For those of you who are watching, would you like to see some afters with the other side toned? And then you can see the difference between the two of it, untoned versus toned. Let us know. Of course, we have time to decide after the live. That will be done off camera, of course.
Yes. Okay, so as we get back into the technique here, what we want to do is now take our next section. So we're going to work the same thing, and I'm going to just point out the visuals here. So you can see on the back that we just did, I would also, just to say, I would do the back half and then bump my developer up by 10. So I'd probably do the back half and then bump up my lightener 10 volume. So I would start 10 volume and then go up to 20 probably. But I'd do back half and front half if I was doing it, because I usually get that question. And the back works like that. You know, you're doing your 90 degrees, and then you take your angles all off of your corners, depending on which corner you're going to take for which angle. The front is a little different. So whereas you would think that they would mirror each other perfectly the way it looks like here, this is a 2D image. So it's a little bit more difficult to grasp the sectioning on a 2D like these versus a 3D. So this is a little bit more accurate, where you can see this actually comes out from the quadrant versus whereas this comes this way. So the flatness makes it difficult. But here we have a good 3D model where you can see that all of our red lines here, that's our sectioning.
Ricardo, those are pink.
Oh, whatever. It's pink. Our pinkish red lines, our coral lines, that's our sectioning. So we have our cross-sectioning here, and then we've taken these, right? That's our first sectioning. And then everything off these corners is the obtuse angle, right? So that gives you a good idea on a 3D format versus a 2D.
Can you do a 360?
Yeah.
Now, this doesn't have all of the foil or the line work that Ricardo is demonstrating today, but it does show you how the angles play a role in either full coverage, or you can do a half or a partial using this technique.
Yeah, so there you go.
And let me just answer a couple questions. We have some suggestions to tone it. Someone mentions toning it. Casey mentions toning it with copper. Don't say that. Ricardo loves Joyico's NCs and all that good stuff.
I have a 10 NC right there. There you go.
He does. And to repeat the IG account, so Ricardo's is, write this down if you're taking notes. Ricardo's is at Stylist Ricardo Santiago. They just put it in the comments there. Of course, at Joyico, and of course, at Cosmoprof Beauty.
Okay, so here's our front section, right? This one, we've only got 3 steps to work with, because obviously there's a lot less real estate on that front quadrant here. So let's work through this really fast, okay? Particularly getting into that hairline. So I wanna make sure we at least get into that. So I'm just gonna move that out of the way. And again, we're going off of these inside corners, creating our obtuse. So we're going here first,
sorry.
There, that's gonna tie into our face frame highlight, okay, and then everything else is gonna come off of that.
So now he's doing an acute.
Sorry, I switched it.
Oh, he switched it around.
I switched it. I unintentionally.
Now
switched.
He's doing an obtuse. That's obtuse.
And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna split this in half so that I can do the face frame with like a V or a zigzag. So here and then here. So this one, you're only gonna get 3 sections. There, move that, have this. But again, this is too big. This, like, I just don't want a giant blonde chunk in the front. Okay, so what I'll do here is what I did on the back portion, which is stretch the root a little bit first, Once we've stretched it, particularly adding a little bit more on that backside versus the front, because we want to keep this a little bit more shallow. So we'll stretch this here.
So sorry.
Oh.
Apologies.
And then, okay, so that's been completely stretched out, and now I can go ahead and subdivide that so that I can create a high and a low contrast. So you can do this one of two ways. You can either split it straight down, or you can do more of this weave, zigzag weave that we're gonna do here.
And again, this is where it's super customizable to the type of hair that your client has, how much, and what their end goal is.
And their budget.
And their budget.
Keep it real, guys. Keep it real. Okay, so then we'll put on our lightener here, and let's go ahead and bring this up. So this part, whenever we're talking about the hairline, it does always go up a little bit higher. So make sure we get good saturation. She also hasn't had a haircut yet, so we're gonna do that afterwards too.
So you will be excited to see, or you should be excited to see the afters. And something else to note when you all are asking about pricing, is maybe consider charging, you know, a base level price, you know, adjust it to short, medium, or long, but also base it off of how much product you use. There is also the great opportunity to charge for an additional bowl of color or lightener. So that's something.
Yeah, definitely something that you can do on that.
All right.
Okay, so there, you can see here, I took that lightener a little bit higher, closer to the hairline here on the underneath. And then on the top, on the interior portion, I actually left it a little lower, okay? And we're doing that on purpose because we want that brighter on the face, a little bit more depth behind that. Now, we'll put a foil down. And now I'm just going to stretch the base formula through the rest of that section that was weaved out.
And Marilyn is asking you, what lightener are you using and what volume, Ricardo?
I am using Joico's Blonde Life right now. So I'm using Joico Blonde Life in 20 volume is the lightener of choice here. And then my base formula again, it's 6NWB, which is a natural warm beige. It's one of my favorite of all the colors that we have. And mixed with 8NWB, I'm creating a 7. So we don't have a 7 in the creams. It's we have every other one, so it's easier to just go ahead and make that with the 2. I did this before with just a level 8, and it was beautiful, but it's too subtle. I wanted to create a little bit more contrast, so I did that for this one. Now here, if you wanted to, if you felt like this was too much, you could always split this in half and then do the same thing, go dark underneath, light on top, or vice versa. In this case, I'm gonna stretch this whole thing. So this is gonna be one large low light. And what that's gonna do is sitting underneath here after the brightness around the face is gonna create a lot of depth right behind to focus the brightness around the face and also contour in some depth into the neckline, which is gonna make that look collapse that hairline a little, or the neckline a little bit more.
Casey says that she loves the way that you formulate.
Thanks.
So if anybody has any questions, please feel free. There's not any question that's not worth asking.
No bad questions. So one other thing, though, that I do want to make mention of, Angela did touch on it earlier. I know some people were asking, but at Joico, I'm going to go ahead and just speak for the company as a whole. Joico is so invested in the stylist, right? And they really do care. They're all about trying to give back. And in that, they have created a sweepstakes that I'm sure that they can post the link on there. But we're doing a sweepstakes that runs all the way through the end of the year. And that's every single week until the end of the year. One lucky stylist is going to win $1,000. So $1,000 every week until the year's over. And I think that that's fantastic and a great way to give back, especially right now. I know a lot of people could probably use that. So That is one great thing that they're doing. Another one is, again, what Angela mentioned, and that is providing tons of education, whether you're going onto the Instagram page and finding that on there, on the IGTV section, or you can always too go onto our website at joico.com, and if you go under the pro category, you can find a section that says pro education, and there's lots of videos, including our previous collections and things like that that we created over the last couple of years. Tons of techniques, lots of advice that you can pull from there.
We have a question from Casey Ricardo. It says, or she says, can you put lightener in the low light last 3 to 4 inches of the ends to give it
more pop at the end?
Work of a balayage look, or would that ruin the dimension?
No, you can do that if you wanted to, like just putting it down through here. You could do that. I'm not doing that because she's already light. So that's kind of the whole purpose of diffusing the color in the way that I'm doing it, because we're just using the lightness that's already there. And I think that honestly gives it a little bit more of a dimensional effect versus adding more lightener down there. So then all the ends end up looking the same. I just like a little bit more variety myself.
And Jackie asks, why didn't you put the last section in a foil?
Because that's a low light. So the low lights I'm leaving out, and only the highlights are getting placed in a foil.
And I think this ties in. Carrie also asks, are you highlighting? Why are you leaving dark roots?
I'm leaving the dark roots because we're creating a... Man, you guys got all the questions.
Thank you for asking so many questions.
So I'm leaving the roots because, again, we want this to have a bit more of a modern feel. And I think rarely now do we see people that are walking around with the highlights all the way up to the scalp anymore. We're seeing more of this like lived in color. It's been going now for a few years and it doesn't seem to be going anywhere. So I'm always gonna maintain a more stretched root versus taking it all the way up.
And we have another question. This is from Jackie. Thank you for asking. She asks, do you mix the lightener in with the base color? How do you keep it from bleeding?
Great question. So the important part of keeping them separate is, again, which formulas you're using. So you want to make sure that you are, hold on, let me make sure I'm not pulling in any of that finished side.
We're so close to you finishing during the live.
I know.
Go.
Okay, so you want to make sure that you are not using a permanent color to prevent the bleeding, and then also make sure that you're just diffusing that color properly. So that's where, and now I'll keep showing the example of how to do that. Okay, so here, right, we've got three big sections here that we're working through. The first one, what I'm gonna do is just like I did on the last portion, I'm gonna take the top section here, and this one, I'm just gonna take some waves out of there. I'm gonna take a little bit more. Actually, that's not enough. That's pretty much the same thing that I just did, but oh well, that works. Okay, and now I'm gonna stretch this root just a little bit. I wanna make sure that I'm blurring this line out. And then we're gonna place our lightener on here. Okay, so I feel like I just need a tiny bit right here. If anyone here has ever seen me work before or worked with me at a show, you know, my OCD sometimes can take over and I have to make sure it's just done right. There we go. Okay, so because I just did that to tie into the last question, that's diffusing that color so that I can go place my lightener on, and then I basically am just diffusing them onto each other. That's going to help to avoid any issues with overlapping. So here's where you can see that I am still just need a little bit more and slinging it right now.
Remember the goal. It's for Ricardo to finish during the live.
Okay, so once you get to here, this is where I know I've already started to stretch that color out. So what I want to do is now take over with my hands and just softly blur that color in. Avoid getting it on that root, right? Just like that. So keep it off that base. So I'll come down with a clean hand, clean finger, and then do the same thing underneath. So you see I have a buildup of lightener. You're just going to stretch this down, stagger it a little bit so it's not all in the same line. That'll give it a more natural finish. Get a little bit here, and I'm just going to take this one a little bit closer to the hairline. Right there. That's good. Okay, so now once that's done, I can take the whole section and just place this in a foil and put it out of the way.
So, and Ricardo is using Joico's Artistry foils for those of you who may have tuned in just a little bit late. Cosmoprof and Joico have shared that yes, the afters will be available after this live. Make sure if you're watching and you found this to be helpful to go ahead and hit the share button. You can share it to your page or you can share it to a friend directly. That way they can also get a lesson on the angle method.
Yeah. Okay, so here I'm going to stretch this all the way down just because I like, again, it's just a weave that's sitting on top of that lightness. So I want to make sure that this is just creating a little bit more dimension, a little bit of depth right on top of that blonde. Okay.
And Ricardo is wiping his hands in between sections.
Every time. So have a nice damp towel handy. Makes it easier. Okay, this is just entirely too big of a section to take at once. So what I'll do is I'm going to split this in half, but with a purpose. So you can either go off of this corner or this corner, and you want to make sure that you are splitting it up properly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to low light this entire panel here and then highlight that top panel there because that's sitting on the surface. So here's this, I'll stretch that. And when I say low light, again, it doesn't mean that it has to go all the way through. It could just be this diffusion that we're doing. And this is just gonna run out about halfway. It's not gonna go all the way through to the ends. See, all of that is left out.
So you can almost create a reverse balayage or an ombre, shadow root, color melt, all those different things with the angle method.
Yes. So I think it looks like we're literally going to be left with one section that doesn't get finished.
What?
I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I tried so hard.
We've got 5 minutes. No, yeah. We've got 5 minutes. Make it happen.
We got 2 minutes.
Paint your heart out. You can do it.
We got 2 minutes to try to get this thing done. All right. I'm going to stretch this a little bit. Again, I always like to stretch it a little bit more on the backside than the front. And I also say that because I'm out of lightener and I'm going to have to mix more. And then that's definitely going to take me over my time. So here we just keep on building this up. But the cool thing is if you see this section that I just finished, I'm going to do the same thing on that last one, except I'm just going to reverse it slightly. And I might, just to break it up because that's literally sitting on the very top at the part, I'm going to make sure that I don't accidentally put the lightener onto that base. I always want to keep the depth. You see here, we're just going to blur that in.
And how long will you require this to process?
She's probably going to process, again, we're using a demi-permanent, so this is just going to process, I'd say about 30 minutes, maybe 20 to 30 minutes. The low light is going to be done processing by then, and then it's really just kind of washing on that highlight.
Awesome.
So this one's going to go in a foil, and I'll at least show you what I'm going to do on that last one so you have a good visual of it. So the last section here, we're going to, let me drop it down. You're going to take this, and what I did on the other side is I actually weaved it out where I took this panel and I just went like this. And so if this all was a low light, and then I left this as a highlight, and this sits underneath, that sits over the top, and that creates the dimension that you see right there and through here. Okay, so that little bit of depth and that little bit of lightness, they coincide nicely together. So that's it, you guys. We just ran out of time. I'm sorry I got to the last section. We got so close, but hey, next time I promise I'll make sure that it's all completely done and I'll mix more lightener. But I appreciate all of you coming in, hanging out with us. If you have any questions, please, please, please make sure that you reach out to me at Stylist Ricardo Santiago on Instagram. And then also, if for some reason, like maybe you want these images or anything like that, we'll make sure that we get those on there and get them to you as well. Again, thank you so much for spending your afternoon with us. I want to thank CosmoProf and Joico for this opportunity to come on and share with you. It was a lot of fun. I hope that you enjoyed and catch you all soon. Hopefully in person. We'll see you all soon.
And thank you for all your questions. Have a great day, everyone.